before we get into the throes of the budget process, we really wanted to let you know what our thinking is, and most importantly, give people an opportunity to provide feedback, to state a contrary opinion if you think there are priorities that we're not articulating that should be moved up, and also to help frame the thinking going forward in the context of strategic planning, so that right now, obviously, we're focused on the next budget cycle, but we need to be thinking the next year and the year after that as well. So we're really hoping tonight that there's some good discussion around this. And specifically, what we wanted to talk about tonight is we were hoping to get a little bit of an update or a status report on the growth that we can anticipate, specifically along the Route 9 corridor, but also in terms of buildings. So I did ask the planning board, the assessor, and the inspector to give everybody an update, because that's really important when we're thinking about revenues and growth. So rather than, again, have that subject to the rumor mill, let's hear it from the folks that are providing the information to the select board regularly. And then we also wanted to talk about a little bit about the fire department. If you recall, last year we decided that with the dollars that we had available, we wanted to give the police department a shot in the arm, so to speak, to help with staffing. And at that point, we did articulate that public safety continued to be an area of concern. So the logical next step in that process is addressing the staffing needs of the fire department going forward. So that's a priority. And then when we asked all of the departments to tell us what they needed to have accomplished so that they could do their jobs more efficiently and more happily, many of the same threads came out, and that involved the idea of a human resource function, which the town does not currently have. There was a lot of conversation about a focused financial director type role, and also information technology being of paramount importance. So again, that's another priority that we're looking at. And I think it also goes without saying that in the midst of all of this, obviously, we're just coming off of a vote that the residents have taken, the taxpayers and voters have taken, indicating that they're more than happy to move forward with a new North Hadley Fire Substation, as well as a new senior center. So that has to be put in the context of all of the planning that's needed around the other buildings as well. So with that, and David, is there something that you wanted to add to that?
I think you've covered a lot of the bases. The only other thing that we talked about was some of our financial management in terms of the open account, in particular, and the free cash policy that we just adopted, as well as a revisiting of the stabilization fund policy, as well as looking to the future for capital planning, and in particular, matching our capital plans with the debt schedule going forward. So, and to that end, we're anticipating any day now a report from the Commonwealth Compact, which is a grant that we received under the governor that looks specifically at issues having to do with financial management and the kinds of people that we have working on our money.
Okay. So anything else anybody on the select board wants to add? Nope. Okay, if not, then maybe a good and a happy starting place would be to talk about what sort of growth is happening in town right now, whether it's commercial or residential. And I was hoping that maybe the kick it off with the planning board. Bill, would you like to just talk a little bit about what you guys are seeing right now?
So residential is not a lot of activity. There is a lot of inventory of approved but unbuilt lots. So we aren't seeing new subdivisions coming in at the moment. Commercial on Route 9, these are in various places in the pipeline, but substantially unbuilt. Pride is coming. Up Farms Mall has two 10,000-square-foot multi-use, multipurpose structures that they have not begun construction on. Happy Valley Medical Marijuana is in litigation, and a butter is challenging that. There was a double multipurpose structure, I think it's 7,500 square feet each, for the Shafi Trust at 207 Russell Street. That's under construction now. Two white buildings on the south side of Route 9. Mill Valley Commons at the intersection of Route 9 and Mill Valley Road is built but not tenanted yet, so that will be coming. Central Rock Climbing Gym is putting up another structure, approximately the same size, for related fitness purposes.
Where's that going?
It's going to be right behind the existing structure.
Behind it?
Behind it. Last night, we approved the Hilton Garden Suites, 96 rooms. We also approved Med Express last night at the Pizza Hut site. There's the senior housing under construction on East Street, and we just took an application for a new solar array from Eversource at Mill Valley Road at South Maple Street. And then there have been a few things moving around. I think they're probably already in the system. Brigade design firm has relocated several times from Amherst to Hadley and then within Hadley, and they're now in the former restaurant space at the Registry Plaza, and a training gym of some sort has gone in where they were. And that's all that comes to mind that isn't already operational.
Bill, can I ask you, what are they building behind where Hillside Pizza used to be?
That's the Lenny Rock's gym.
Oh, up that far?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought they were going on the other end.
Well, they're putting a small storage building right behind the Pizza Hut.
Oh, that's what it is,
yeah,
the storage?
Yeah, 20 by 40 of that's a storage building just for storing stuff.
But it's thought it might have belonged to the bike.
Yeah.
But
I'm not sure what it belongs to. The climbing gym is directly behind it. It's a lower building, it's not higher. It's the front.
The bike shop had come in for an expansion, but then they decided to expand within the existing structure. And this is a little warehouse, mini warehouse for them that you're talking about.
And one other question, we referred to residential buildings that are in the docket. Where are most of these located, and basically how many?
The Burfield has several subdivisions within a subdivision off of Shattuck Road. I think there's about a dozen lots there, give or take. There are 10 lots off of Route 47 in front between My Street and the old B&M building that's available. And
it's a small subdivision on Huntington that has a couple of lots unsold and a couple of lots in development.
So there's probably a total of 20, maybe a little under 30, give or take around 30 lots available.
Hawks Meadow built out?
Which one?
Hawks Meadow, is that built out?
I believe so.
Okay.
If anything, like maybe one lot, I'm not sure. More than one.
So, Tim, did you want to talk? We're talking a little bit about some of the obstacles that we have in front of us in terms of, I mean, obviously, this is all new growth, which is only going to help us going forward.
But. Well, the biggest stumbling block that we have is natural gas.
Yeah.
There's been a lot of inquiries to my office in regards to specific projects, but most of them are restaurants. Restaurants are basically dead in the water right now due to the natural gas issue. There is one restaurant that's possibly trying to go into the Hampshire Mall, but right now that might not be a possibility because with the natural gas issue, they looked at the last large use and they're using a 2-year time frame. And If you have any possibility of exceeding that, they're not going to give out the permits for it. So that's the biggest stumbling block we have. The other one is that we all know that hotels are probably the best thing tax-wise for us because it's really three times the tax base when we start looking at all the revenue that's occurred through room taxes and everything. There's been inquiries for additional hotels, but generally most of the hotel chains now want four stories. We don't have that. There's several reasons for that. The primary reason is that we don't have the fire apparatus for a fourth story. I don't think that that is a something that is, it certainly is a concern, but I think we can overcome that if there's enough need for hotels that want to go to four stories. We have one existing hotel that wants to put a fourth story on the existing building, but right now that's almost a something we can't do based on fire and based on our zoning. So we do have some restrictions on zoning. I really believe, my personal feeling is that we've had very good zoning, but I think we're also seeing a little bit of a shift in regards to future uses in retail and other things that we have actually restricted based on size. And maybe we should get some qualified people together and look at our zoning and what could be possible for the future. Certainly the McMansions are going out to some respects, but there's a different lifestyle going forward with the new generations. And I think it would be wise for us to start looking at some of that. On another front with the malls, luckily Pyramid has a new regime in place, so they are actively pursuing making major renovations. We are in the process of a large renovation down at the JCPenney's end, and there's more to come down there. They really are trying to get some diverse type of stores that are advantageous to the college students back in, but that's going to take some time. Their major problem is the natural gas issue, because some of the conversion estimates that they have were huge, hundreds of thousands of dollars to make some conversions over to either electric or other types of energy sources.
Mm-hmm. Not so much the stall.
Is it another moratorium?
Do we know? Is there any movement
on the gas moratorium? Status.
The status is, the latest is that luckily the governors of New England have signed with Canada an agreement for to bring in energy through from Canada.
I suspect electric energy for
yes.
gas.
And that's if when that goes forward, that's going to reduce the natural gas load from producing electricity. Then in turn, that'll go back to individual uses. And there is certainly discussion about a new, I don't know what they call it, transverse line from one line over to our lines on the Northampton side. That will probably help increase the Pioneer Valley down here volume. That's desperately needed.
The electric project is not supposed to be done until 2019, if all goes well, with the Northern Path. So you're looking at no relief until...
It's going to be years before we have those relief tests.
But it's still worth, I mean, there was some movement with the legislative body when they were flooded with complaints, and that's when Stan Rosenberg actually led a group and made demands of the DPU to come out here for a hearing. Hearings were held, there was an awful lot of conversation, and then they said, well, we're taking it under advisement for 6 months or something like that. But I think that continued constant pressure on the legislative team isn't a waste of effort, and just keep reminding them, because they have other priorities too, and I think these things kind of cycle through. So I would encourage everybody to reach out to John Seibeck and Stan Rosenberg, call the office and say, what's going on? But that's about all we can do. Tim was instrumental in getting letters together from our developers last time. That was extremely helpful, and that was all turned over to DPU for evaluation. So from the planning board standpoint, I mean, Tim's talking about possible zoning, you know, taking a fresh look at zoning, and you've been doing a master plan updated. Is there anything that you're actually contemplating right now, or?
The height issue hasn't been an issue for us. No one has mentioned it to us, really.
This is the first we've really heard that somebody wants something taller for grade, or something like that. This is new to us tonight. Mm-hmm. Nobody has come in for anything except that.
Well, we did have actually come in.
He wanted an adjustment of a specific thing, but we did that, but that was not going to give him another floor.
Right.
And we would have to think about it, because that goes into the scale of Route 9, which we're trying to keep somewhat subdued.
If I remember correctly, the reason it set it to what it is so that you could continue to see the vistas as you drove down Route 9 over the mall, so that's what the limit was put there.
There's probably more, there's no reason why the scale of Route 9 is what it is. You know, there's fire protection, there's the scale, aesthetics, the whole bit, consistency. So there's a lot of things that filter into that. And, you know, it makes sense to raise the height for good reasons. We're willing to listen. So.
The immersion school's 4 stories, right? The Chinese immersion school, or is it
yeah,
kind of depressed?
That is in a specific section. It's the industrial section that allows a little bit more height.
Oh, okay.
Where years ago, we were looking at the mall specifically for one project, and that was increased for those type of things. But, I mean, there are advantages and disadvantages, just like Jamie said. It's a big advantage for hotels, or it might be a disadvantage for something else, but what other thing would build 4 stories? That's the thought process. I think that it could be something that might be advantageous to look at. We do have good zoning, but some little tweaking here and there might be
another one that's probably been a killer for a couple of projects, and we put in my petition for the 75,000 square foot big box. And the age of the big mall is probably, I'm not going to see it again in our lifetime. The malls are a dying breed. Putting in, you know, big building, but the mall itself, Super Walmart, they're not building Super Walmarts anymore. They're not building this big superstores, very few and far between. They're trying to become a more, I don't want to say a smaller store, but you know, there are some stores that are interested in coming in that would, or businesses coming in that would be pushing the 75,000 square foot envelope, and that's probably something we should consider altering somehow.
What types of businesses? You mean like office park type, or?
Well, the last one was NES, they're very, very apprehensive to go forward. That was the one that we said we probably favor variance on. But the issue comes to financing, and they're very apprehensive to go forward with something as a variance. So, like Jimmy says, the big malls are dead. Big retail space are dead. That was the reason to limit the size. But you know, unfortunately, at the same time, it limited the business, the office park. That could really come in here. And I think there's still a need for that, now that we're getting out of the economy slump.
Yeah.
I think we have to realize that technology has changed the business atmosphere drastically, like Amazon.com.
Yes.
These big box stores are having a tough time competing, you know, with free shipping, you know, and any of the ones in the mall are finding that out. It's a very difficult environment to operate in today.
Seeing some large scale medical office buildings that are being built, though. And I'm not sure if the square footage on those are, but are those the type buildings, are you saying that we're missing out on?
You mean like Kurt Shumway's, the Atwood Drive?
Yeah.
In Northampton?
We've seen them up in that field, Route 5 area, down in Northampton.
We're only 2 floors.
Is there any movement on those buildings in the mall area where Florence Savings Bank used to be and Burger King? Have you heard anything?
Well, that's one of the things that you brought up.
The 10,000 square foot building that Bill talked about was tearing down the old Florence Savings Bank, Burger King, and putting in 10,000 square foot buildings in their place. But last we knew, they were just trying to get tenants for those buildings before they start doing any construction.
So it'd be similar to what's across the street, you think? Something like that?
No, these are, similar ideas. They were open to what would go in there. But it was definitely going to be similar. They were looking for more retail spaces.
But two of the tenants that they had lined up were restaurants. And their high consumption on natural gas, and they both, there's no way that they can go in. So when they look at a tear down and new construction, you tear down, there's a energy use there on natural gas. That's a lot. So if that's X amount, unfortunately, restaurants use 2 or 3X, three times as much. They won't allow them in, they won't permit. So luckily, we've had a few, like Texas Roadhouse, that were willing to spend the money and put in the propane, because later on, the hope is that they can convert it over. But not all these companies are willing to do that.
Was Burger King gas before?
Yeah. They had the gas grills.
Yeah. Almost all.
So no pre-existing conditions can allow?
But there's a time frame on it, too. So, and then it goes off the books.
Johnny.
We saw that that happened actually near the Sears building. They shut it off through renovation on one area for a year, and they couldn't get the gas back up. So it's a huge problem. It's the biggest issue this town has, and it's got to change. We're going to not
seeing
the good growth that we should have.
What I would like to see is, from East Street to Spruce Hill, that's in the historic district. I don't know what's so historic about that. I'd like to see that converted back to business. I think the business, such as the rock climbing business and the, sports center, the
dogs,
place.
Dogs, babysitting.
They're going to be a strong business because of the businesses that Amazon.com actually are taking and ruining our retail business. Mm-hmm. I also would like to see the sign bylaw lightened up. People need to advertise. Our businesses need to stay healthy and stay in business. And if not, we're going to be paying rebates and everything else to malls, and these businesses are going to be gone. So, I think it's a serious matter, and it's not getting any better. We need to get smarter.
Get out in front of it.
Relative to that, you mentioned the solar array down at the South Maple and Moody Bridge. Are there tools or things we should consider, the board should consider, about being able to steer some of that into probably, let's say, more desirable spots versus less desirable spots? Some ways to control where you're going to put solar and how much?
Well, there's certain areas of town that we've zoned, we've zoned pretty much all over, but there's really no good way to try to steer it in certain areas and not out of others. It's permitted by law, and we can't prohibit, we can only regulate that kind of stuff within reason.
We have a lot of wide open spaces, and you can see some large view sheds being, you know, tainted a little bit by large solar arrays on.
The only thing about a solar array is it's easily removable, and it's, when it's removed, you pull the whole side of the ground, and 20 years from now, you're back to where you were 20 years prior. It's not like you do a lot of concrete and gravel, pulling out all the good soil.
David, did you?
So in that particular solar development, I know the Conservation Commission is concerned about it for the reasons they talked about, but that's a viewscape that is under development by the federal government. So they're working with the developer in order to find another place for that.
What I would like to see on my solar is a green shield from the road, whether it's an arborvitae blind. I think they're totally ugly. You go down the side of the road, that's all you see is these panels all over. And if it was allowed and it's available, is to put an arborvitae road, a minimum of 6 foot, that would block all the view from the vehicles out to the fields. You don't look at open fields anymore.
So just sticking with one other aspect of revenue and growth, Dan, from the assessor's standpoint, could you just, do you know, well, I'm sure you do know, could you share with us when the next assessment cycle is and kind of what you're thinking you might see in terms of commercial residential?
Growth, residential, the houses that are going in are no longer the $250,000 homes. They're in the $600,000 to $900,000 range. So they're going to be bringing in a lot of money. Get 10 of those, that's $80,000. Commercial, the projects we're working at now, that's not going to be in the property. Mm-hmm. At least, if not one, the hotel probably won't get assessed until July of 19, which is actually fiscal 20. A lot of the other projects are going into existing space, just reuse. That's not going to generate a lot of additional revenue. Mm-hmm. Our commercial growth has really taken a hit the last 7-8 years. I mean, we're looking at solar has kicked in $85,000 in the last 3 years. Solar growth is great. Mm-hmm. Doesn't add kids to schools, doesn't require town services, and they're paying $85,000 a year. Residential is, it's not that great. Yeah.
And how about from a valuation standpoint? Where are we?
I think we're going to see a lot less growth this year than we got last year. Last year we got $195,000. This year, we're probably lucky.
I was thinking actually in terms of like property values, like the assessed values of commercial and residential.
Values have been pretty much stable.
Stable?
Yeah, the commercial, some of the commercial stuff, the building values are probably coming down, but the land values are going through the roof, especially in the Amherstown. I mean, they're looking at $1.5 million for a 40,000 square foot lot, which is incredible that a few years ago it was a couple hundred grand. But that's not really considered, under DOR, that's not growth. The land value increases, unless they actually subdivide. Some of the things that to point out that Tim said, the building cap has hurt, the building size. We had someone in our office that was looking to put in a 150,000 square foot hotel conference center, and they couldn't, there was nowhere to put it in. I mean, almost all of our land that's zoned commercial or industrial is full.
What's the limit on the growth? If you're saying they can't spread 150,000 square feet, it has to be up?
I believe it's 75,000 square feet is the limit now. Max building size.
They can put up 150,000 square foot building provided the footprint does not exceed 75,000 square foot.
But they were looking for probably about a 30 to 40 acre site. Put that in, and there's really nothing, there's not a lot left. There's two more solar that are potentially coming in, eating up the last two large commercial sites.
It's brought out mainly, it's not allowed in the business district.
Well, it's in the industrial zone.
Okay.
That they're coming in, and they're, it's basically going to finish off all the large-scale lots where you could put in large, so you're going to be looking at a 6,000, 8,000, 10,000 square foot building.
Do we have a building lot still left on Holly Road that was forfeited?
I believe so, yes.
Why can't we not sell that building lot now that the town owns it and turn it into revenue for the town?
Talk to town council.
It's tied up in litigation?
It's our issue.
And we own it, right? Now we own it.
That would be the responsibility, and I'm not going to throw the authority when it's up, the battery pump, the selectmen, the town council.
I think that's what we could look, we're sitting on $150,000 there maybe that we could look at for revenue.
I think you better check with the conservation.
Well, I know.
Because it's awful wet.
Is it part of the aquifer recharge area to where it is?
Yes.
But it's still buildable though, right?
You can't get a tractor in there to hay it.
Well, we can talk about it. So thanks, I mean, I think that the point was, is really important because as we're rolling forward, obviously with the budget cycles and looking at expenses going up and up, just trying to get a handle on, is there any way for us to quote unquote grow ourselves out of, you know, ever increasing expenditures? And I think what we're hearing is we have a lot of opportunity in Hadley that other municipalities don't have, but it's squeezed and we've got constraints, specifically this Berkshire gas issue.
So what Dan was talking to, that would involve, we realize we are close to build out in our business core, mm-hmm. and I include industrial in that. The question is whether we go up or go out. And in our talk on the master plan, there has been no sentiment for substantially enlarging the business district. And to that end, we really don't have a 30-acre parcel to spend. It would involve basically taking that much more out of current residential, agricultural residential, and adding to the business district, which is a policy discussion for town meeting at length.
Mm-hmm. What do we have left in West Mass, and is there any interest in that property now by anyone?
The vitamin building is going up, if it isn't already up. And once that's built, there really isn't much left on that parcel besides maybe a couple of little small buildings of that parcel pretty much.
So maybe we could, just in the spirit of time, kind of segue, since we're talking about buildings, maybe we could segue over to the non-revenue producing buildings, which would be those town-owned buildings that we have. And, you know, I mean, obviously everybody knows the senior center was approved and the North Hadley Fire Substation, but I'm just wondering if the Municipal Building Committee, do you want to give a little bit of insight on kind of the, that those are two projects, but then it's not the whole story.
Yeah, actually I'd like to make a comment on the revenue side as well, just as an architect, you know, as I'm watching us discuss, you know, what kind of revenue can be gained from a certain kinds of development. I'd like to just encourage everyone to start to think a little bit about how we could build a community for ourselves in terms of villages or districts or places where us as residents could gather. And I think we kind of lose sight of that when we talk about Route 9, we talk about the malls. And you know, I've always thought that if we could encourage a certain kind of pocket of development somewhere near town center where we could take advantage of some of the open space of West Street in the proximity of the future senior center and library buildings and have more of a walkable center where there could be potentially restaurants or mixed use. Maybe it's Railroad Street, maybe it's somewhere else. But I think, as I said during the interview of the for the long range planning, you know, I think we lack that kind of space where we meet and greet each other on the street while we're walking, just simply running into each other. And I think that building some kind of more robust town center for us would be a big value, and I know that other people feel that way.
And right now, that's really the historical overlay district, right? Yeah. And I know that that came up specifically with senior housing as well, right, during the master plan update. There were a lot of people proposing, encouraging senior development in this area too, for that reason, because it's walkable, access to services.
It's interesting. I believe that the town of Weathersfield, Connecticut, was developed by the same founders that founded Hadley. They just came north. And if you go to Weathersfield, you'll see the town green, but you'll also see a very robust retail area where there's a sort of main street where you walk and there's shops and hairdressing and restaurants and all kinds of places. And it's very active, and I think it's very successful in that respect.
You know, it's quite obvious in their tenure as a building committee, they've done a very commendable job getting these buildings back into shape. You can't do it all at once. But we, as the select board, have a responsibility to give them an adequate budget so they can maintain these buildings in the future and not them let them go backwards again like it did in the past. So that's a big thing forthcoming in this budget cycle, getting them the right amount of money to continue to maintain these buildings in the future.
But we got to do something with the buildings first, right, before we can maintain them, correct, David?
That's right. So just a quick summary, and you guys feel free to jump in. Wasn't really prepared to say much, but we stand ready for the different committees to support the OPM and the construction. We have members that are representative of those two committees on our committee, so we get kind of regular updates on what's happening with the senior centers and with the fire station, and so we're prepared to assist any way we can. As you know, we've prepared a lot of critical needs projects over the last 2 years. Many of those are complete. Some of them are still underway, and there's a few that this spring we'll be working on. I think probably first and foremost now for our committee is to develop that budget for keeping up our town buildings, and that's been kind of the focus of our agenda for the last couple of meetings. We're getting there. I recognize that there's a lot of different budgets that are in different pockets within the treasury of Hadley, and how that all works for town buildings and the schools and everything else, I think is something we have to work out. What else, gentlemen?
The chairman of the finance committee asked a question I don't think you heard of. What do you anticipate to do with Russell School?
Well, the program, the building size footprint, and the multiple stories and the nature of the building as a historic property with very limited capacity in terms of floor weights and things like that makes it kind of difficult for reuse. We don't have a very specific program right now for Russell School, unfortunately. We recognize it is an icon for the town center and is important to the town, but I'm not sure that we see a town department that fits perfectly within that that footprint. And I think, if anything, we might be interested in some of the town hall departments and what their longer term needs would be in terms of more staff and more space. If we see that the town hall needs to grow larger than it is, that might be an obvious location to move some departments. But we're really unsure of what exactly those specific departments will need over the next few years. And I know there's been some work towards that, but I don't think that we have a solid program that we can use.
Have you considered at all putting it on an auction block and let somebody buy it, like for a medical center, which would be an ideal location for it, and they would have the money to revamp it but still keep it looking historical, so you keep it as the icon in the center of town?
I would say not at this time, because right now we still want that option to be able to develop that building for the town's use, and we haven't really come to a conclusive decision that we don't need it at this time. So I think I'd like to hold off on that, or at least.
And how about Central Station? Sorry, David, do you want?
I was just going to say that the town of Hadley controls 3/4 of that intersection, and in that way you anchor your historic district. And David was talking about a livable, walkable community. Giving up a parcel on that central state intersection. You'd have to take a, forget about the building, just take a look at the land and think very carefully about the implications of divesting of that parcel.
At the same time, you have to realize the town of Hadley is not in the real estate business. We can utilize that building and get tax money for it. It would certainly add a great deal of revenue to our budget problems.
We still have projects that we're going to be displacing people. When the new senior center is built, in order for the library to be built, the Hooker School has to come down.
As an opportunity for swing space, it has some.
Swing space, and then you're going to have another open building with the library as the other library moves forward with their project. So now we're still going to be a holder of another building sitting on the corner of the middle of our district. So, you know, we're not done with being property owners at all.
Not in the near term.
In as much as I think it's important to have those icons in the town center, I also think that keeping them as town relics unused in programs is what's going to kill us. It's just going to make this town center inactive and loss of time. So I think, you know, our goal is to try and find some program that we can use there, but it's been an uphill battle, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, as much as some of our committee members, we all love that building. It's our favorite building. Architecturally speaking, it's a beautiful building. And I hope that if we did decide to sell it, we'd put the right kind of historic preservation requirements on it and such. But I'm not prepared to say, you know, we won't ultimately someday recommend it be divested of and protected and upgraded by somebody that can afford it someday. So that's
Well, you yourself have seen a ton of buildings that have happened. You've done buildings yourself that you refurbished themselves, old buildings. So I take your word for it because you have the knowledge of anybody in this room of what can happen with old buildings, you know. So I think moving forward, I think we have to, what's on our plate right now and look and move forward with those things. And we have people we're displacing from the senior center, so we have to find room for them.
Johnny, do you want to?
I have a question today. Do you have any plans where you're going to place the planning board with their plan room and also a meeting room for their hearings? If they're going to knock down the building, where are they going to go out, the street or where?
It's since the election happened, I mean, we were kind of waiting, holding back to see what the results were of the of the election. And now that we've seen the mandate from that, where it's going to be time to work with the select board and the affected departments, and there are several that don't have a designated spot down the road, that we're going to have to figure out where as a committee we can put them. And honestly, the Russell School has been is a challenged building. There are some issues there that, you know, made the building not appropriate to have the previous tenant in there. So it's a building that has some concerns or some constraints on the site, and we're trying to figure out what we can do with it, but it hasn't been a priority. We've been moving through the other buildings, trying to get them straightened out, and you know, certainly Russell School is on the horizon for us to contend with.
I just wanted to add that I think it would be a really great space. I'm not on the building committee, but Park and Rec needs a space for children to play safely outside. And our last vote took both green spaces away from our department. So we no longer have any green space for us to play in, nor do we have our autonomous building. But the Russell Street School would certainly be the only space in town right now that I see a safe place for children to play, certainly outside. The fenced in area and the field next to it, and the proximity to both schools, certainly the Hopkins, this school, is also a large benefit to that building. I know it's a lot of money, I'm not suggesting it, I'm just saying let's not forget Park and Rec when we think of that one last building that we own, and more importantly, the green space.
And did you want to talk a little bit about the public safety complex?
Yeah, I just want to first say that, John, in partial response to you, we did issue a survey about a year ago. Maybe it was a little bit complicated. Maybe we didn't push it hard enough, but the responses were not all that robust in terms of all the departments responding. I'm not saying your department, you know, they're just, you know, I think we probably could get some more intelligence out of it, and we could better understand what everybody's needs are, and you know, the planning board, everybody, and start to understand what additional needs you might have that might help us program buildings like Russell School.
Yeah, I think that should happen sooner than later.
Yeah, and as Andy said, we kind of want to wait for the vote to see if this was going to move ahead, and now that it is, it's got to go back on our agenda.
I don't think it's imminent with Park and Rec. You have all that area outside of the parking of where the Council on Ages is now. They're not going to be breaking ground out there at least for a year and a half, probably.
But that building is not meant for children, so we're not...
No, I'm talking about the play area. You say you have no green space.
Yeah, but we need a space, and we need an indoor space by law. You need a space for children to be able to access bathroom.
Outdoor space with green space. You know where that soccer field is?
Yeah, we've used that...
Chinese emergent school uses it for soccer sometimes.
For soccer games, yeah. The games we play generally are at the elementary school, and or Hopkins gives us their field, but I'm specifically speaking to programming where there needs to be an indoor and outdoor facility.
So you're like saying a small like gymnasium or something like that?
Or just an area that we've had in the past several, all of our years has been the North Hadley Hall, so that every day in the summer there was programs inside, a Lego, an art, a science, a theater program on the inside of the building, and then the outdoor space is required to use for running around and gross motor. So you need both during a day. If you have children a certain amount of time, you need to be able to be outside and let them run and play for a bit. And so, yeah, just a space for field play is one thing, but we do have some space on the fields in the schools. But in order to have revenue-based programming for week-long programmings or eight-hour-a-day programmings, we need an interior space for, you know, storm shelter and bathroom use and just the necessities, out of the sun, that kind of basics. Well,
as far as our buildings, the reality is we're not even close to halfway with regard to departments and the needs of and the requirements of the town. So we're only partly there. So Park and Rec is a priority, certainly with our Municipal Buildings Committee and what to do with Russell School. We got a long ways to go on all these other departments. DPW, the whole nine yards, everything.
Well, and just to remind everyone, we issued an RFP last year for land at Town Center. We did get one response that our committee felt was favorable to. Two responses.
One favorable.
One favorable for contiguous land within that senior center parcel that would ultimately build out a town center kind of campus for the town buildings. And I think that could solve some open space issues related to athletic fields in the short term. If, you know, in a few years you decided you wanted to look at a recreational center or something like that, that's available. So, you know, our committee would probably recommend that, and I don't think we've made a formal vote on it, but that
but keep it as an
considered.
Option.
Yeah, certainly a community center was one project, or at least a concept that was considered. I wouldn't rule it out yet. And one another thing to consider as far as the athletic fields, the school has been a great partner. When the fields are available to Park and Rec, they've had an opportunity to use it. I just want to remind some folks that with the two new buildings that are going up, that's the North Hadley Field and the soccer field behind the senior center, that takes away the non-school green space that was used for organized sports.
I guess that leads me to a question about that area again. Now, where the Council on Aging building is proposed, is that lot sufficient enough to hold the size of that building?
Let's just answer to that, but from my understanding of the initial program, it's adequate.
Without acquiring additional land?
It's long and narrow and not ideal, but it's adequate to put a building. So if we had more contiguous space there, we could do something better. We could build something that could potentially be expanded, or we could use share, you know, we could share parking with a community center someday or something like that. There's a whole campus plan that could be established if we we were smart about how we did this.
But that also includes the parking lot at the upper side of the Legion, the parking.
Right.
That would, that's part of the town land.
Jack, so where are we with the land out here? That's
the
Yanners.
The 7 acres.
7 acres out back at all, or the campus fields that...
We just got approval to have 15,000 of CPA funds to relook at the design. And that design will specifically look at how we can phase that project so we can afford it over time. And we'll also look at what can be done with town resources, volunteer resources. So we're talking to Gosher Design Group now, right?
So we have a conference scheduled on the 23rd. It's the hope of the liaison of the school committee, Paul Piper, and some other folks to set up a community meeting and invite some input on what makes sense in terms of phases, what the community thinks, and then respond to some of the questions about what community members or which community members might be willing and able to assist in terms of volunteering. We'll announce that we have the town hall as it's been set.
Does the school feel at this point that they would need all of those 7 acres for the plan that's been in place? We revisited that plan for a number of years now, so that's, you know, what I'm looking at.
Well, the current design is using the whole space, but it also includes a community walking track around the perimeter, but expands the number of baseball fields, soccer fields, softball fields.
So that you're not having to bus over to the Young Men's Club and things of that nature.
Right. Just keeping, and expands for full
keeping everything
use.
Here.
So could we talk about Central Station?
One
of the things we're talking about, obviously, is going to a full-time... You guys were, like, falling asleep down there, so...
Yeah, I mean, as far as Central Station goes, we've made some... immediate repairs, the project for the roof repairs, the roof re-roofing project is pending. We were waiting to see how the vote played out for the fire substation to better understand the equipment needs of the department. And I know that you've had a few meetings recently to discuss full-time fire, you know, and all of that. We haven't really taken that under advisement yet. You know, maybe some of my committee members know what's happening there. I don't, but that's certainly next on the agenda, is to talk about the longer term needs of the Central Station.
Yeah, there's been a number of projects, as you know, to stabilize that building, mm-hmm. and there's a few more that are pending, pending funding and weather and the like, so including the roof.
And the air conditioning.
And the air conditioning, yes. Yeah.
And we're going to be talking about the ambulance needs, too. That the startup of that committee should start pretty soon. Ambulance.
I think as we looked at expansion, and I know Mike's been somewhat involved in this, is you know, there are office space on the south side, there's the apparatus bays, and then the north side potentially lent itself to expansion if you were looking at dormitories or other components of the program, which might sacrifice some of the recreational park field parking there. But to sort of piggyback it so that there's program space on either side of the apparatus bays, which may or may not separate police and fire. You know, we haven't really worked that out, but it's feasible to do some expansion to it. And if we were to do something to the north side, we could do a kind of more robust construction, you know, as a lot of people have had concerns over the initial quality of the construction at the public safety complex. So we could do it right. There, and it's just a matter of getting together with the chiefs to talk about what their needs are longer term.
Do the chiefs want to talk a little bit about what you're seeing coming down the pike in terms of staffing and potential impacts on your home?
Madam Chair, I would like the fire chief at least explain to everyone what we lost in the SAFER grant. We put all our eggs mm-hmm. in one basket. We were hoping to get that grant. We were denied. And I think that could lighten the load a little bit to understand what we're up against today with staffing and the reason why.
Well, we put in the SAFER grant, the staffing grant,
federal government. It's no, mystery, but we were denied along with a lot of other engineers, a lot of hammers also for the staff. The main reason it came back was the fiscal need. So the federal government, part of their response to our request was, you need to show us additional information as to what your fiscal need is based upon all the information we presented. We have a low tax rate, we have a very low, everything is across the board, so it's people with other chiefs. It's pretty much, a lot of other communities are much worse than they are. So I proposed in June of 16 to the select board a five-year phase approach, and phase one was attempting to get that safer grant. And I can tell you right now that we are, being at a tipping point for a number of years. We no longer can handle the call volume, the types of calls, the inspections that are required, the outreach, everything else that we should be doing with our community, which I think we're still doing a pretty darn good job considering that there's only two of us in the station. But we can't maintain anymore. The initial numbers were short 2 months for 2016. We will be again being over 1,000 calls this year, with 70% of the calls during the daytime hours between 16 and 16. So the alternate phase one was to request part-time staff. I don't think that is any longer on the table. The budget that I proposed is to request 4 full-time firefighters for daytime staff, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. I'm still working on the layout and all the tasks and the job description and what you can possibly see for revenues. Potential revenues with what they're doing, also sharing tasks between departments, and what else it would include for outreach with seniors, with the school department, with the 4 schools we have in the community. You have probably all seen the post on Facebook on how Amherst is just completely overwhelmed right now. They are struggling to keep up with their medical calls along with their regular calls, and we're part of that basket of calls that they're receiving. We respond mutual aid to Amherst, to Sunderland. We even had our first mutual aid response to East Hampton for the first time since I've been on the department. And I can just tell you that staffing is an issue across Hampshire County and across the country. We've worked with the Western Mass, or actually the Mass Call Volunteer Program. They received a SAFER grant for staffing and retention. That program brought in a substantial amount of funding for outreach, advertisements, media publicity, and also scholarships for folks that would, young folks who would join up for college tuition with deferrals. So if they're going to college, they couldn't make all the calls at that time, they could do it after that. So with that program, with the consistent Facebook posts, media posts, top calling you folks, the selectmen's meeting, working model, for the past almost close to a year now, we've been promoting this. We have received 2 volunteer applications. One of them was rejected, and the second one was brought on to the fire department. However, they live in Northampton. So we've increased our distance for travel to attempt to try and get additional folks in. That doesn't help us on an initial sign-up as a call force member. I give ad nauseum numbers to you on what our response times are, and we're not complying with NFPA for staffing. OSHA, 2-in and 2-out rule is difficult to come up with. I hear folks telling us that Amherst will get there before we do. I had one resident say that the Chemer Road fire that we had, that South Hadley was there. There were no Hadley fire trucks there. And I can tell you I was one of the first 3 on site with an engine. And it was all Hadley trucks that were there before any of our mutual aid assignments could get there, even having to go around the lovely bridge that we have an issue with. So our call force numbers have increased substantially over the past 5 years. We're down to approximately 22 active, you can drop that number in half or less. Folks are too busy with their job, with their families. The amount of training you need is substantial. You're looking at 200 plus hours just to get a basic firefighter one program. You're asking folks to go into fires. This isn't asking them to play a basketball game. This is putting their life at risk. I can tell you that the gentleman that went into that fire on Shmurda Road, I have never been so attentive and nervous about having to send your own folks into a fire like that. If you could possibly get a grasp of how quickly this fire spreads now, this new construction, it's insane. And, you know, we're attempting to save not only lives, but people's property. You know, that's probably what you'll see more than the lives. However, I remind you of the Holyoke fire that occurred 2 weeks ago. That was a 25-room apartment complex. We have 5 40-room apartment complexes over at Winfield between senior and family housing. Luckily, they're sprinklered. However, sprinklers are designed to control the fire. They're not designed to evacuate smoke, and they're not designed to always be able to handle a catastrophic fire. And the list keeps going. We have 6 hotels in town. We have another one coming on board. And the hits just keep coming. So the request is to have 4 full-time staff. We're attempting to combine what their positions will handle. We've talked a lot about bench strength. Currently, I don't have an acting deputy chief. We have all force firefighters that right now I have 1 captain, and I have multiple lieutenants, but they don't have the time to commit to a deputy chief's position. They're asking them to, you know, they need to be available. I need to be able to take some time off and not be concerned about it. I need to be able to go to a basketball game or a soccer game for my kids and not sit there listening and my wife can attest to it. Every time that pager goes off, I have it up to my ear, praying that somebody will show up. So we need that bench strength. So the request is for a full-time deputy chief, a full-time lieutenant, potentially mechanic, who would be able to handle all the interior equipment. We have hundreds and hundreds of pieces of equipment that consistently need to be maintained. So that would be their charge, and then 2 regular firefighters. It would be a 2 on, and it would be a 4 on, 4 off staffing plan, so 4 days on, 4 days off. Rotating schedule, and if, with all the numbers that I've come up with now, it looked like a daytime staffing of 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Under the federal regulations, you're allowed to require up to 53 hours of straight time before they receive overtime. So we're evaluating all that to see what we can get the biggest bang for our buck. The overtime that I put in is extremely minimal because what we would offer up, which has been very successful in Granby, South Hadley, Southwick, is to offer up to call force firefighters if you have somebody taking a day off to see if they'll cover that shift and just pay them that rate. So there's a lot of good opportunities here, and it would be in addition to our fire prevention lieutenant that we have. So we could make that minimum staffing going out the door with a full assignment, including myself. As far as the headquarters, this would not be an overnight stay at this point. So it's not as much of a rush to get sleeping quarters. That VRA report was done, I think, in 2012. I went through the building with, at that time, with Chief Upwitz, and we did put together some proposals for redesigning the building, adding space, trying to centralize the dispatch center so that the police would be able to obtain more of the space for dispatches, and then fire and police could share office space like we are now, but potentially creating new with that addition we're talking to the north end. So that's something that we have looked at and would be happy to work on if we need more and take a deeper look at. Mike and I have discussed consistently how we can start decreasing our budgets by combining them so that we're sharing resources. We've done that. We've also been working very hard with Marlo and really making sure that our maintenance budgets are getting pushed into the DPW where they should be. So So that money has now been transferred to the new budget, and we're seeing a decrease in our budgets on some of that equipment as well. Unfortunately, our equipment's not getting any cheaper, but Mike and I, we've already combined our radio budget. That's been on board for the past 2 years. And fire extinguishers, we used to have fire extinguishers all over the place that weren't being inspected. That's now been cleaned up. So we've really, really been working to just, we don't have to flop our budgets. We have really cracked down the bare bones. So I was requested to give out what we could potentially give out to the rest of the departments. And like I said, I think the schools know that we're 100% behind you in what we try to do in planning for doing fire drills, lockdown, everything else. Without additional staffing, we could increase that even more and bring in more of the state programs that I used to do so heavily. We've been in the library. Every year we go over to the library. We'd love to reach out to that program even more than that. And obviously, we work closely with Park and Rec, all the seniors, the senior center. We just spoke for 94 seniors and a lot of information on how they can keep themselves safe. So we're extremely active in the community with that, and we could do an awful lot of work for that. So that's what we could put out for your departments with that. As far as what we can share, I made a commitment that, you know, if you take a look at the level funded budget, the only increases in the level funded before the service is just the cost of maintenance and then increases in equipment costs. That's it. There's nothing else, and obviously the contract of COLAs and things like that, but
Mike,
it's pretty insignificant.
What's a ballpark estimate of the cost of the four full-time?
The cost of full-time is, I have requested, this includes Nick McKenna, so the current fire lieutenant, is $256,657.
Okay, so we're looking at about $250,000.
Right. The overtime is 160 hours, and that's based upon what their pay rates are, but it's not substantial. That's basically 30 hours per firefighter.
When you're referring 6 to 6, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., are you saying it's 7 days a week or just weekdays?
That's correct, 7 days a week.
7 days, okay, I wasn't sure.
So, and like I said, I've done research on the call volume, and the past 2 years, 70% of the calls are between those daytime hours.
Mike, could you house those persons in the current building? Would you need additional space or renovations if you were to get that?
Well, depending on the status of the North Avenue station, there is office space slated up there, so if
sure.
They have space to be able to work, that certainly would be reasonable to put two firefighters up there with engine three or whatever vehicles up there, because it would be an immediate response.
Thank you.
Plus, we would have two firefighters that are set to center station.
Anybody have any questions or thoughts they want to offer about the fire?
Just a general comment that in a way we are a victim in talent of our own success. Mm-hmm. We have an extremely low tax rate. We're also considered one of the wealthiest communities in Western Mass. Mm-hmm. And that's for a variety of calculations, like all the doors off there. That because it's still being calculated in all the numbers are done. I can tell you how many arguments I've been into a different meeting with different groups, people at Hamilton Tens. I made that comment and they disagree with me. I just check your numbers.
Yeah.
Your per capita income is drastically lower than Hadley because of the students. And they check in here whether I like it. That's correct. That's a correct statement. And, well, that's why we don't qualify for a lot of freebies. Because when they look at the numbers, wait a minute, you've got this, and you want something free, get out of here. And we've got sooner or later they're going to pull me up to the board and pay the money.
Mike, is there any chance for the Zephyr grant, instead of it being for four members, could it be done for two? Can we resubmit next year for two as opposed to four and put two on our payroll ourselves? Would that indicate or show that our willingness to support half of this? Or you think it's a dead in the water?
It's in all honesty, it's been more than not even, I mean, for them to reject cameras with the number of calls paid out. Like I said, I spoke.
Who qualified? Who got it?
Holyoke.
Holyoke, yeah, okay.
1.4.
And they had two fires on top.
All right, thank you. I appreciate it.
I think. Where?
Where was even 2 years ago, they will be applying again, but again, talking about a community as a very low.
You know, when we traveled all around looking and talking to fire chiefs and police chiefs for the North Hadley Fire, I was amazed when we went to Orange. Over 50% of the people living in Orange are impoverished. They're getting Class A fire trucks for 5%. But I certainly want, you know, they closed another 300 employee business the week we were there. So it's a very tough area. This is why the grants are going to those areas, because they haven't got the funding to fund them themselves. It's quite obvious.
Mike, do you have anything to add?
It's the federal government's money, you know. So.
Is there anything else our other chief would like to add to the equation?
Yeah, I think one of the most important things is our staffing issue is the consolidation. It's something that was kind of hammered into my head since I took over. Was what can we put together to get more benefit across the state? And, you know, Mike's jumping some hurdles right now that I just recently went over as far as how to solve some of these problems. And there's a reason that consolidation works. It's, you know, it's going to work in this situation so long as it gets the staff. It needs a true second point. My most exciting part for me in my department would be the lieutenant position, which would be a combination of candidates. I fully intend on taking advantage of that individual and having them fix our cruisers too. That is the amount of time and money that's going to save, and that's you know, as far as consolidation of budgets, that's police and fire, but Marlow is going to benefit from that as well, just because of the workload that it could be taking off of what we put on the DPW. So that's a huge plus for us. Not to mention the fact that we're going to have full-time, or we could have full-time firefighters going out the door with the police to assist when you're on calls. You know, it's just, it's an invaluable thing to have. Moving back to the building itself, to answer the questions that were raised earlier as far as where are we going to put these folks. As far as the police department's concerned, I think we made it fairly clear over the last several capital planning committee meetings that we've been out of space in that building for a while. And we've requested and received this past year the increase to do the locker room upgrade, which, you know, we've needed for a few years now. I don't think that we have an issue doing this in stages. If that's what's necessary. They're going to need more room. We definitely need more room as far as office space and kind of setting the building up in a better way with adaptations done and growth in certain areas. We can put that building kind of together in a way that works better for both agencies to be in there. I should say all three, because we have communications department to worry about as well. So, you know, we're totally willing to work in stages and do it as we move forward. Like I said, I actually just spoke with Tim today. We're setting up a meeting next week to talk about how to move forward with the locker room project. And we'll take, you know, the next thing as it comes. I was really happy to see that this, I don't know if these were numbered in any particular order as far as the priorities go, but I was really happy to see that the fire department was one of the board's priorities.
You know, I'd just like to thank both of you chiefs publicly for all you've done for Hadley. You grew up in those departments. You've made those departments the strength they are today. I commend both of you, and you both love working in Hadley. The only thing I don't want to see is you guys get burned out because you're doing too much. And you have lives too, you have young families, you have to take care of your families.
Well, that's why it's up to us as a town and a community to support our infrastructure and our fire and our police as we support the schools and everything else. I think it's just a part of the thing that's been always on the back burner, and then now is the time for it to come forward. So I think everybody has invested in this, and just by us hiring Mike and Mike and Marlo and, you know, Susan and all these new people that have come in and to the community, we just want things to be better, and we've already started that, and we want to help you finish it.
Well, that's one of the other things that I would say that, you know, thank you, Donald, that kind of reminds me. You know, I have a lot, I have a bunch of supervisors, and I have a lot of officers, especially young ones that are willing to jump in and help out. So I have a lot of people that I can delegate things to. Mike doesn't have that.
Sure.
And Mike handles, I would say, 95%, if not more, of all of the issues that occur with that building itself. I don't have the first clue how to deal with the HVAC problems. That has always been something that he just, it was probably like that when Dennis was in the building. I know it was like that when Shanley was here, and he just kind of continued to do it when I took over. It's where, when he said that he's at a breaking point, it's not necessarily the department or him alone, but we're at a point where it's time to get him some help so that he can, you know, when he does have to handle those responsibilities, he doesn't have to worry about running out the door to a car accident as well.
So I know everybody's going to want to like go home at some point here. So we also wanted to talk about human resources, information technology, the finance. Maybe David could touch on that a bit, but then wanted to allow for time also for people to talk about what may not be on our priorities right now that you think needs to be brought to everybody's attention. So do you want to just talk about?
Sure. So at the fall town meeting, we raised money for the server for the town hall.
As well as yeah, I was going to say, can you?
So at the October town meeting, we raised money for the town hall server and some of the other technological upgrades there. We're currently working on a RFP to get that out the door. I've also been contacting HCOG to find out if there's any way that we can improve our customer service relationship with Paragus. I've done a survey with some of the other towns around here that use Paragus, and they're universally unhappy with them. And so we have a contract with HCOG, and I'm going to explore the possibility of having terminating that contract in June and going out with another RFP for service. So that's where we are now. We have another $35,000 coming up with the capital plan for the next 2 years, $35,000 each. That'll complete our 5-year strategic plan once those are funded and implemented. So that's the IT department. We've had some preliminary discussions about sharing IT resources. We should revisit that.
Yes, so I mean, for human resources IT, we've talked about purchasing, we've talked about a finance director. You know, obviously that would be an awful lot of hires that we can't absorb, you know, right now. So I think we're trying to get creative and recognize that we have a functional problem, that those functions just don't exist in an appropriate way or in a way that's useful to the municipal employees. So whether we have to look at outsourcing, whether we have to look at shared services, whether within district or without, contracting out, we're trying to figure out a way to get the help. And again, to Mike's point, we may not be able to do this overnight, but we're committed to making it happen, even if it has to happen in stages. So, you know, again, the more suggestions and thoughts, the merrier. We're on a path to try to make that happen, and we don't know exactly what the solutions are yet, but I think this budget cycle will help, you know, engender some discussion on that.
So I talked to Sandy Pooler, who is the budget director of Arlington. He formerly worked for the town of Amherst. He's willing to come out and give a presentation about what a finance director can do for a small town. I've also reached out to some of the other communities to see if we could do a sharing arrangement with finance directors. Right now, I'm talking to South Hadley as a possible partner. I have been talking to Amherst, but that didn't work out, so there's some opportunities there.
If our COG was as strong as the Franklin County COG, wouldn't that be very helpful to us as far as the rest of the communities?
It would be unbelievable.
I mean, every community has to have these exact same problems with finance and et cetera. I mean, we're not in this on our own, and that's what COG should be doing. I think we should. Donald, you're a representative there. I mean, I would like to see if there's any possibility that some of these things are consistent with our communities, our brother and sister communities around here, and if there's any opportunity there to get them involved with this. I mean, if it costs us something more for the COG, we understand that, but if we can get financial advice and financial people involved and some of these other things that we're short right now that we just can't fund. We can't add 3 police officers, we can't add 4 firemen the next year and still fund everything that's here that we need on the table. We need some help with some of this, and I think the COG would be a great place for us to seek out to see if they could do anything to help.
Already spoke with them, and they're looking at some of these areas, and the COG is just like us. They don't have an ability to raise revenues through taxation like community. They have to look for other areas of revenue to augment their budgets. So they're very interested in these areas where we could share with others some of the hill towns.
I'm willing to pay. I mean, I don't want to pay the full share, but I'm willing to pay and be part of it.
So, Jerry, the other option is Franklin COG is actually more than, on so many levels, than Hampshire COG. Hampshire COG really isn't even a council of governments. Pioneer Valley Planning Commission serves Hampden and Hampshire County. We do have contract planning services from them. And I will certainly explore with Tim Brennan whether they can provide a level of service.
Didn't even think of it, Bill. Thank you.
Yeah, that'd be great. So, you know, again, we wanted to kind of share, this has just been a conversation at this point amongst the select board and the tri-board meeting of the finance committee and the schools about kind of what our priorities are heading into this budget cycle, let alone obviously level services for, you know, for everybody, making sure that we don't take a step backwards anywhere. But you know, we wanted to give people the opportunity to also share any thoughts about areas that maybe you think that we should be have at a higher level on our radar right now or prioritize that we haven't talked about tonight.
Madam Chair, I think it sort of sounds like you're being closed, but I think it behooves us to give the school a couple minutes just to give us a little direction what you think's happening into this budget, because you're the biggest participant, over 50% of the community's total budget. So if we have time, they've been sitting there very quietly, and I think they could provide us with some crucial information.
Well, they're gathering their thoughts. I would like to follow up directly on what Molly was asking about. And then, and playing off a little bit about what the fire chief was saying, the planning board is like a volunteer fire department. Mm-hmm. We have been operating without staffing for the 30 years that I've been there.
And you've done a great job.
We'd appreciate that. Yeah, thank you.
Next.
We're going to live forever. There is a looming hole if we are not still willing and able to provide, and I'm running for re-election, so I'm still willing. I'm still willing, but
a lot dependent on these next few minutes, Bill.
The ability to carry out our legal obligations of planning functions, to lay out subdivisions, to approve site plans, depends on 4 of us showing up physically at every meeting. Mm-hmm. And we have a five-member board, and we don't always get everybody there for every meeting. We don't have staff backup, we don't have, we're not part of the IT solution. Do you know how much town data we have on my server and Jim's server, or Jim's home computer?
WikiLeaks.
Every document that the planning board generates, I'm the clerk of the planning board, virtually every document the planning board generates lives on my computer, because we have no access to anything at town hall. All of the public hearing notices that Jim sends out, all of the correspondence he has resides on his computer, because he has no access to anything at town hall. The IT plan explicitly said, about page 3, we didn't talk to any of the volunteer boards about their IT needs. So,
And along that line too, Peg, our Hadley Public Access Television also has some storage and retention issues that need to be wrapped into the IT.
So, I'm not proposing a solution tonight, but you asked if there was something you were overlooking. Yes, there is.
Okay, and again, I think from a, what would be extremely helpful, I think, is contemplating other renditions of the planning board. I mean, what other options exist in terms of structuring that are in use in Massachusetts?
We have those ideas, and we'll discuss them at the appropriate time. Because one thing we need to do is put our literally thousands and thousands of drawings on electronic file. Mm-hmm. And that's not an exaggeration on the amount.
Yeah.
We've got this vault that we got from UMass, I think, planted at the highway department, put it in there, but it's about 5 foot by 4 foot by 4 foot tall, and it holds, I don't know, how many thousands of drawings. Well, it's full. Mm-hmm. We took all of it that was in, rolled up in the files this summer, and we filed them in there, and it probably weighs, I don't know, 800 pounds of drawings. Mm-hmm. If it ever has to be taken out of there, you're going to need a couple of very strong boys and girls. So when our office gets moved, there's going to be some mighty heavy lugging.
Well, it sounds like we need a dedicated conversation with you guys to talk about the future. Did that give the schools enough time to collect your...
Well, thoughts is an overstatement. I have one. Did you have another one to make the floor
open? Yes. The school committee hasn't met to look at the FY18 budget yet, so it's too early to say much about the budget. The good news for our regional workforce and our regional economy is we know we have a lot of kids interested in Smith-Vogue, and that is good. If you look at the statistics of what our region needs in terms of workforce, it's middle skills, so that's very good. What's not very good about that is that there will be a cost that we're going to have to build into the FY18 budget.
Has there been any further conversation about, again, Smith-Vogue is an anomaly? They don't function, they're not funded the way the other vocational schools are? Is there any movement on trying to wrestle
with? Well, we've talked in the tri-board that we could look at changing Vogue schools. And I think that would need to be a regional, town-wide discussion. I think we have a strong tradition of our kids going to Smith-Vogue. They don't have to go to Smith-Vogue.
So they could go to Franklin?
Go to Franklin, they could go to Lower Pioneer Valley.
Dean Tech.
Yeah. You know, one other thing I'd like to mention about our school system. That's why our houses in Hadley sell for more than what they're even asking for. Sometimes you get 3 or 4 bidders, because we have a quality school system. We have people coming to Hadley because of the schools. They want to raise their families here. And it's really an important thing to keep funding our schools adequately, because it reflects so many more areas than just the school system at Hadley. It helps everybody in the town, every department.
So, Linda?
Yeah, I want to speak a bit about the HR issue which we've kind of breezed through and have framed it in terms of another job that that needs to be filled, or another expense that we're going to try and meet. But I want to get back to what we're really trying to do as an all board, which is solve some of these things for all the boards at the same time and not just add a position here to help this one or that one. And HR in particular is one that I look around the room and there's not a single department here that has not gotten bogged down in the past year and a half with some kind of a personnel issue. And the thing is that there is no particular department that's in charge of handling it. It's somewhere, the responsibility that falls somewhere between David as town administrator, our treasury department handles benefits and payroll, so a lot of those personnel issues, so that comes here. But there's really no one in charge and no one that's really skilled, trained, and has the background for handling some of the issues that have been coming before us. We can handle paperwork, and we do that, and I think we do it well. We do the employment, the workers' comp claims, and process all of the paperwork. But there's also been some other issues that we really try to figure out every single time. So, when we talk about a job like that, and I hear the needs of the department, I'm like, oh, I don't want to compete with that. But an HR job really is one that should alleviate all the other positions. The chief can spend more time being the chief if he's not going to some of these issues. Really, honestly, everyone here has had something that comes up. So I think that there are positions like that and others that have been mentioned that so much in so many departments that they can be looked at a little bit differently and see how they might help us save us money. And we talk about revenue, how we can make more money to spend our money or how we can save money, but really some of these positions save us money even as we're spending it. And whether it's new money or whether it's a way of reconfiguring or reworking some of these, some of our positions to cover it a little bit differently, something I honestly think is needs an outside help. I don't know if we should be looking at it. We did have that grant problem that they came out and talked to us months ago about how we do things differently. I haven't heard anything about that. I don't know how we should arrange things, but we need some help.
Right, that's
how to address them.
Yeah, they've been promising that report. You're talking about the Commonwealth Compact folks?
Yes, well, that was covered in finance directly.
Yeah, but they...
And HR.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, we're expecting that report,
but it's taking
them far longer than we ever expected. We had thought we had that back in December.
It's not always...
Not the Collins Center, it's Department of Revenue.
Anybody else that hasn't? Marla, are you going to talk about infrastructure? I can't believe it didn't come up.
Well, we have many projects going on and just starting. As everybody knows, Mike and Mike discussed a little bit how we had been talking about the buildings and consolidating things over to what is under my tutelage, the building maintenance budget that had 5 lines on it. Now it's increasing to 10 or 12. And, David and I are working on those things. But as far as infrastructure, we've put a lot of time into grabbing the maps you've heard me talk about the last 10 months and what are real, what are as-built. We're in the process of tying bond, putting that app together for water for us. The sewer's pretty much complete. The big news is next week we're due to install the first set of cassettes in our water treatment plant. We're supposed to be arriving tomorrow, so that's pretty exciting. It's a pretty big project for the middle of the winter. As well as the other thing I really wanted to talk about a little bit was the equipment and touch on a little bit of what Mike was talking about. He's got 30, 40, 50 pieces of odd equipment. Chief Mason's got odd equipment that we can't get to, the little repairs, little maintenance items that they need done. And I've talked about a responsible capital plan with equipment since I've been here. And it's no secret that most departments have received a big shot in the arm equipment-wise, especially the DPW recently. And first and foremost, thank you. But I think what's important to run off what Mike said is We need to stick to good preventative maintenance with our equipment. We got a good shot in the arm, it's a good opportunity moving forward, looking out 10 to 15 years and swapping equipment out slowly, slower if you will, with a less of a harder impact per year on cost to the taxpayer. Better preventative maintenance will allow us to get a better trade-in value for the equipment going forward. So as far as my department, I'm looking at doing a lot more things more proactive than reactive. Proactive makes us much more efficient, as we all know. I would like to touch a little bit on the HR thing, coming from a community that had an HR department. I think David and everyone does a great job of what they can do, but I noticed even my day-to-day issues and was what I come across during the week that I think an HR position or help in that area would streamline everything, again, proactive, and would allow the people that are kind of filling in with those areas to really become real proactive or be able to excel in the positions they're in. I think a position like that is money well spent, from my experiences. They run with the day-to-day issues, the legalities of things and all that. So other than that, stay tuned. We've got a lot going on this coming summer. So.
Any final thoughts from anybody? Anything we didn't? Mark?
I think we're going to be dealing with the aftershocks of one of the tax increases by the taxpayers. There is going to be some adverse consequences for further tax increases. Just to temper everybody a little bit, we're going to have about a $20 million budget, right? And I look forward to working with Dave and Linda and the rest of the finance committee to get all our numbers, try and iron out as best we can, put things in queue, so that we do this in orderly and proper fashion.
Okay. All right, so Suzanne, did you want to say anything, or library, or anybody who hasn't spoken tonight? I mean, you don't have to either. I'm just making sure if anybody has anything to offer.
No, I support everything that I've heard tonight and anything that I was in conflict with. I just want to say that our time frame for being in, we won't be putting shovel to the ground in a year and a half. We'll be in the building in a year and a half if our time frame goes the way it's laid out. So that's one thing that we'll hold off. But other than that, I appreciate all that Joan does for HR. She's amazing. She watches things and catches things that I don't, and I'm very appreciative of that. But I feel like maybe she could use some help. And the town in of itself is putting itself in a position of liability without having. I've mentioned to David a couple times some of the things that might have occurred to me from working up north before using consultants. I don't know how they flip insofar as from the private sector into municipal sector, but there are entities out there that you can use for resources. And I also want to say that even though I'm not a Hadley resident, I totally can see how she's bankable in a growing community, and you're talking about all the growth and how can you continue to be self-sustaining and how can you grow more. And it's the thought to the visualization to me about putting the cart before the horse. If you can change the variances to get bigger buildings to help sustain your town, you need to give them the equipment and the personnel to be able to put that fire out before those buildings are built, plain and simple. But that's just the way I think. But he goes above and beyond to reach out to every sector. And I've said to him before, I don't know how he does it, but he's everywhere, and he does a fantastic job. So I just want to say thank you. And I know my seniors feel that way.
Yeah, see you, John.
I guess when you referred to me, I was sort of a little astonished when you said you'll be in the building in the fall of 18.
Yep.
We were told our architectural phase is going to take a year, just for architectural. And we have a simple building compared to yours.
Oh.
This is why I can't understand how you can be in it by the fall of 18. We're looking at probably what, John, is your committee looking at? What are you thinking? 19?
Well, I think there's going to be more opportunity for this conversation.
I'm sure we'll have more opportunity to discuss plans as we move forward.
So, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Would you like to say something?
Hi, I'm Drew Hutchison. I haven't met all of you yet. I'm going to speak loud because I'm not Mike. I'm the director of HadleyMedia, and I've been asked to come in and assess, evaluate the facilities, the equipment, the workflow. I'm in the process of doing that. It's very clear to me that we need to upgrade a lot of the equipment to reduce efficiency so that we have more labor available to actually help each department. And what I would like to ask you to do to help me out, is think about what kind of stories do you want to tell the citizens of Hadley? How can you educate them? I'd like to make maybe little 3 or 4 minute videos from each department. We're going to put them on a new website that we're creating, and they're going to go, if we watch, they're going to be, oh my God, I can't believe that this is how good it can be, because it's going to be amazing. It's going to take a while. For instance, tonight we had a train wreck for the first 10 minutes. The sound wasn't coming through. Basically, unplugged everything, plugged it back in, and it worked. I mean, so that's where we're at. We're starting here, and we're going to be here, and we're going to get there together, and I'm going to help leverage what we can do to make your jobs easier. So I hope that sounds good to you, and please talk to me whenever you want, and I'll do what I can to help you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank everybody for their time. And the other thing that's really important too is thank you for the feedback tonight, but also as you work your way out of here and you think about how the meeting went tonight, again, this is a work in progress. We're trying this. We're trying to improve communication. There may be things that went well tonight, things that didn't go so well, so more than open to that feedback so that when we hopefully come back and do something similar in the fall.
We need a better room. It's very, very difficult to hear.
The space is an obvious issue.
Yeah,
we got to figure out. If that wasn't screaming for
meeting
space. Yeah.
What's new? But the chair had looked at Hopkins tonight.
What's that?
Hey, public meeting space.
So anything else before we wrap it up?
We have a potential 1,000.
Thank you.
Maybe you should tell people.
Much better than last year.